Okay. So my name is Holly Haux-Jeffers. I'm an artist here at Brickwork Art Studios. But right now I want to talk about the work of Jude Domski, who is one of my absolute favorite photographers. And we're going to start with these works right here. They're taken from the West Coast. And the first time that I met Jude and saw her work, it was this piece right here. And it was in a different format, but I saw the piece, I fell in love with it. I fell in love with the light, with the colors that she gets, with the lines, with the movement. At one time it was oriented differently, and then Jude changed the dimensions of them and started putting the pieces together and playing with colors and rearranging them. One of my favorite things about her works is that you can hang them the typical way where you can see the ocean and the horizon line. They're beautiful that way as well. But when you look at the pieces here, either individually or together, and you step back, to me, it makes me think of perhaps tree bark, or if you're looking at the end of a book and the pages are edged and things, you can just get lost in them and let them take you to another place. She's done a couple of series of them. They're all fabulous. And with this one, she played with the idea of, color gradation. So there it is. It's fabulous. It's on the West Coast. It's a place called Cape Disappointment. And you can take a minute to get lost in them. They're spectacular. Jude does a lot of work. Her water pieces are the ones that I am most drawn to. And after I saw these, I told her that she could come to where I live, that there was a little beach on the end of Killarney Drive in Burlington, Vermont, that at that time there were a lot of neat sand dunes, and she could come photograph anytime she wanted. And she did. And what you can see here, hi, come on in. There were more in the series, but right now we have 6 pieces that you can see. And each individual piece is fabulous on its own, but then when you see them all together too, again, they're pieces that I look at and I love. I think of it as like Zen chess, because sometimes we play a game where they're beautiful like this, but then we'll just rearrange them. To call them, for me, when I call them water photographs, yes, they're photos of water, but really when you look at the lines in them and the colors, there's like a journey or something magical in them. And she can be all technical about how she does that with her camera. All I know is that when I look at them, they just make me feel both inspired and at peace at the same time. And that's a pretty incredible feat to do. So that's this series. Yes, so there's an ice piece here, that's gorgeous too. So she has a series where there are that are a bunch of different ice pieces as well. But like I said, there were actually 9 that were just what we called the ripples. But of course, those have found other homes. And so this was a piece that she added here. So it is, if you were to look close, what you see, this is actually, there's just a big wave coming in that's breaking. So that is water. It's just that it's a very thin still piece. So it was very shallow, and that's the beach, and the water's receding, and there's the wave crashing.
Is that a really big wave?
No, it's a very small wave. It's a very small wave in the fall, that was coming in. So it's not big at all. It was probably that big. So Jude will photograph a lot of times either in the morning, so morning light or in evening light. But what she also does is she can set them up on her computer and she can play with color variation. So she has pieces that are, natural. That's what it looked like in the light. But then she has other pieces where she can manipulate the color. And the bright orange one is one where the color was manipulated. So.
And this is The Shape of Water?
Yes, thank you. This was part of a show that was called The Shape of Water. So the first pieces that you saw were part of that show. This was part of that show. And over here, we're going to move to a group of work that was taken from Bristol Falls, Vermont. And these pieces over here, you'll notice that there's some different shapes. And Jude's idea with this work, it's called This is a Jazz Song. So she arranges them in different formations sometimes, but you can see these are the big keys on the piano, and there's the little keys on the piano. And again, I think one of the most amazing things about Jude's work is that you can just look at this one piece. You know, you can take just one, and that can draw you in. And you can even, when you look at that, you can hear the water falling, you can see all the designs. I mean, they're incredible pieces. But she also has the ability to take them all and put them in a series and just create a whole new feeling and motion with them. And I'll tell you, that in and of itself is an art form, even besides, you know, her photographic skills are phenomenal. But the way in which she then arranges them, too, is just, to me, mind-boggling in the best of ways. Well, so you are right that that does seem like black and white, but some of these were, in fact, that was just the natural state that they were taken at. It was very, very cold. It was in the fall when she took them. And the other idea that Jude was playing with these was, if you look at them, there's almost like a Japanese calligraphy with them. So she had actually printed some of them up on rice paper and had, you know, just different ideas in her head that she was playing with when she did these. And right now, you know, the final piece that you see here is the one where it was the black and white and thinking of it as music and how would you put it up representing a jazz song. But again, so hence the black and white for that, to keep that part of it simple, because it's a very complicated piece, you know. It's very, you know, it's, imagine if this was in color, that would be incredible too. But even with simplifying it with black and white, you know, it allows you to really see those other details. So if you've ever sat by a waterfall, right, and you think about each individual droplet that needs to come together to form this, you know, you can get really philosophical and think about that piece where it's one, you know, here, come here. So I'm going to steal that we have, yes.
Oh,
she's such a whiner. I know. This is Jude Domski.
This is
she's
a spokesperson.
There you go. And now she will go talk to some of her other people.
I want to show this picture at the back lot. Come.
Okay. So they're going to go so they could look at her other work. There you go. Thank you for your patience. So we were talking about the black and white and being by the water. So just that bit of that, you know, there's one drop of water, but then you have the whole river and you have movement and you have something that in fact becomes very complicated and musical and magical. And those are the things actually that, you know, when Jude talks about what she was thinking of when she did the pieces, it is fascinating for me because it's very technical. She will be talking about, the light that she saw and that she was trying to capture, you know, making sure that things were really clear and playing with, you can see she plays with dimension, but she is also looking at it, you know, looking at where are the white parts and then where are the dark parts in it. So her camera is her paintbrush, as it will, you know, so she's moving her camera around trying to capture that, which I think she does very well.
Water.
Well, I think you might have said it all. Well, you're right. So there's the shape of water, right? And the beauty of that is that it's free and it's experimental. You know, when I say free, I mean there's a freedom to it. And, you know, it's experimental, it's fearless, and it also, you know, you said it starts in a cloud. Well, who's to say it didn't actually start in that river and then it went up in the cloud after? So I'm just saying, you know, it really depends on your perspective and
it's
what...
Condensation.
Yeah, and that's the beauty of artists and viewers too. What I see when I look at these pieces, what I hear in my mind, what I'm inspired by, is completely different than what inspired Jude, and each of them is completely valid. And that's the beauty of it. You know, that's the beauty of artwork, that what the viewer brings to the work that we see. You know, maybe it will never be spoken about. I'm sure there are people that have looked at Jude's work and never said to her, you know, how it made them feel. And it doesn't matter. What matters is that they saw it, and that there was, I'll call it the silent exchange, you know. So, and that's just as important. So that's why we do it.
Now, water is the most important thing, one of the most important things on this planet. Mm-hmm. I think it's overlooked a lot of times, and taken in that direction.
Well, yeah, when I look at Jude's pieces, you're right. One of the things I love about her work is that she doesn't take anything about it for granted. Maybe that's what she captures, that that essence and the importance and the beauty of it, you know, without shouting in your face about it. She just presents it, and you know, we can then ignore it and go upon our way, or be moved by it. And everybody that I know that has ever seen Jude's work stops in their tracks. Okay, all right. Okay, if we come over here, this is a very different view, but you can see. Here's another way of looking at Bristol Falls, right? We're not looking at the droplets. We're looking down over and having a completely different experience with the water. And again, she has the dark and the light. This one, it actually, I'm going to turn this light off for a second to see if that helps. So it's not a black and white. And if you get in close, there's deep, deep greens and aquas. And, you know, and then that aside, just look at the whole, you know, the shapes in there. She's a you know, sorceress with the beautiful stuff that she creates. So again, the shape of water, you have ice formations, you have it flowing in between, you know, it's also a very graphic piece. She's incredible. Here, so if you look at here and here and here, these are actually in Maine. These are Maine tide pools. And there are a lot more pieces in the series than I can show you right now. But it's beautiful to see them together because of the colorways. But then here, the piece we hadn't actually spoken about with water is when you look at the reflective properties. Because a really neat thing about these pieces is that you can see the detail. You can see the seaweed in there. You can see little pebbles. But what also looks like clouds here is the, you know, the reflections that were happening from the sky above. So you get the best of both worlds. You see the movement that the water creates with the pieces underneath. You see reflections. So it's at once, you know, detailed and intriguing. But then you also have, you know, the reflection with, the, you know, the light sort of flowy ethereal bit. That's with it. We saw smaller. We saw the square version of one of these pieces from ice. Here you can see there's a different dimension of that. So like I said, you can see it in a square version and be beautiful. You can, you know, see them in a different format. And, you know, they're all phenomenal. The green piece, too. Jude, the green piece was a main tide pool as well, so I'm sure, or no?
That was Bristol.
Ah, okay. Bristol. All right, so yeah. So this was Bristol. Yeah, okay. So you see, you know, on this one, you know, you could say, ooh, it's a psychedelic piece. You know, it is. So you've got all of the above. You have this phenomenal color. You have the movement. You have, you know, then you, again, there's the reflection with the white parts. And, you know, she's limitless. And she can capture all of it. Some people are good at one aspect of, you know, their craft, be it photography or portraits or whatever it is. But, you know, Jude within her photography, and this is just with water. This is just taking the idea of, water, the shape of water, and, you know, what she created. In a very short amount of time, I might add. She's amazing that way. So I just can't wait to see what she does in the future, too. I'm going to be the first one there. So that's it. Right now we are at Brickwork Art Studios. This is the last First Friday Art Walk that we will host here. However, we do have a Facebook page where you can go and look, because as we find our new homes, I will post that on that page so that you can look and say, where can I go to see Jude's work? Because yeah. I'm craving it. So what she means is JudeDomski.com.
It's fine.
Thank you guys so much.
Okay, my name is Lyna Lou Nordstrom. I am one of the artists at Brickwork Studio, Brickwork's art studio. And tonight is my solo show, and we are standing next to my artwork. This first piece here is a collagraph, and it is done with collage materials that have texture. Then it's inked up and printed as if it were an etching. This one was named by a friend of mine, but I think it's very appropriate considering what's going on in the world. It's called Fragile Earth Theory, and this is number 2. I work in monotype, collagraph, solar plate etching, and silkscreen, whatever happens to catch my fancy at the time. This piece is one of my nature print series. I actually take real plants, lay them on a piece of plastic, kind of like a plexiglass surface that has already had ink on it. And that's why what you see here is the negative space, because all those plants prevented the ink from printing. I print these on a handmade paper called kitakata, and then I mount them on a substrate of a heavier printmaking paper so that they're easier to mat and frame. Okay, so actually, prints has become kind of a hard word to understand, because there are a lot of prints that are done by a mechanical means. All of these are done, they're hand-pulled through a press. The paper has a slightly damp dampness to it so that it will absorb the ink right, and also it will also pick up the plate mark. If you're looking at some antique prints, you want to make sure there's a plate mark. Otherwise, it's a copy. All of these are one-of-a-kind originals, and this one was done with the plants themselves printed on the paper. The etching press makes it possible to do all kinds of things because the pressure transfers the ink onto the paper. An etching press is created by... An etching press has a big roller that's made out of steel, and when you put a piece of something you're going to print on the flat bed of it, it will start to bring the bed right under the roller, and that pressure on that roller on that print can be adjusted, but the roller helps bring it all the way through to the other side.
And is that electrical, or do you
look at... No, it's all by hand. They do make them electrical, but I've understood from other people that actually when they're electrical, sometimes they can get away from you, so I'm glad it's by hand. I choose all kinds of things. This happens to be one of my favorite leaves. It's a dandelion leaf, and most people aren't real fond of dandelions, but I think they make an awesome, awesome imprint. And then there are those little tiny seeds from the tree, and those vary with all different kinds of trees. This I call stars at sunset. I don't know if you can see them in this particular photograph of it, but they're tiny stars up here, and it looked like a sunset to me. And how many times do you look out and see stars showing up even when the sunset is just happening? I had the opportunity to work on something called a monothon, and it was the first time I ever had the opportunity to use this kind of paper. This paper is a handmade paper called copper plate, Hanamula copper plate. It's made in Germany, and it almost feels like fabric when you use your fingers on it. All the prints that I make, I dampen the paper slightly. This gets rid of some of the sizing in the paper. It also makes it more able to accept the color. I would consider everything that I do pretty abstract, even the plant ones, because I don't necessarily make them look like they're growing. They might just be patterns in the piece. This one has lots of other colors added to it, and I was getting introduced to RNF pigments, which are these beautiful pieces to draw with, and it feels like you're drawing with lipstick. So I was able to draw directly on the plastic, and that printed from there as well. I call this piece Fountain of Joy. When I was doing it, I was feeling very joyful. I was in Santa Fe working with one of my mentors. Catherine is a fantastic artist, and she was helping us work with many layers. This piece has gone through the press many times. It is, if you look closely, you can even see places where I scraped the ink away. But it is all, to me, it's a very, very joyful piece, so I called it Fountain of Joy. And if you could see it in person, you'd realize how many layers there really are. All of the ink that I use for this is soy-based non-toxic. When I first started doing my monotypes, I was working with oil-based etching ink. But I am very happy to say that the results I get with the soy-based Akua inks makes me just as happy as the oil-based ones did. This piece I named, I Know Spring is Coming, I Feel It in My Bones. I think all of us have felt that way this spring and wondering when spring is really going to come. One day we have a summer, the next day we have winter, and then we have spring. This one just has a very, very soft feeling about it, and it's definitely abstract, but I still feel like it's an indicator of spring. This is a very early piece, also from 2000, and what I really like about this piece is the movement of the hearts. I called it dancing hearts because they are actually look like they're jumping around in there. I think I cut those hearts out before I put them on there to make the shape. I didn't want to use anything that was commercially done. I actually cut those hearts out so that they would have a more organic feel to them. Yes, yes, I am going to finally get around to making Valentine's by next Valentine's Day. Because I ended up making a lot of heart things. And actually, hearts are for any time. You know, hearts are, there's no real season to hearts. But, of course, we definitely exaggerate it at Valentine's Day. Okay, we're going around the corner. This piece is called Feather Dance One. It was the first piece I got into a Monotype Guild juried show, which made me incredibly excited. And that show was in New Hampshire. And I was just learning how to move the ink around in the background. So I have a lot of ink moving around. I also have plants in this one. There's a flower. I don't remember what kind of flower. Flowers can be any kind of flower as far as I'm concerned. They don't have to be anything special. And I love the teal color. It was a lot of fun working with that color. There is a feather there. That's why I called it Feather Dance. There's also kind of I play around a lot with cheesecloth because I can manipulate the shape and the direction of the feathers and also the raw edges. So there's some of that in here. It's just a really fun piece. I really think it's a dancing piece. This piece has a real special significance. It's called Tribute to Zhu Ming. I was at Johnson Studio Center for the Vermont Artists Week, and there were two people there whose work I really admired. And one of them was Zhu Ming, and I'm sorry, but I can't remember the other guy's name. He was from Malaysia, and Zhu Ming was from China. And I was working, as I always do, with lots of movement and lots of direction. And when I saw both of their work, I felt really inspired to continue to make that very active kind of motion. Zhu Ming wasn't a person who inspired me because of his abstractness. And also, I asked him if I could go see his artwork again. Well, he looked at me with the most dumbfounded look because he didn't speak any English. He had no idea what I was asking him. And the guy from Malaysia was behind him, and he translated it. And so finally, we set up a time so I could go and meet at his studio. And when I got to his studio, I don't know if the guy from Malaysia translated it different on purpose or if he'd misunderstood me. But when I got there, Zhu Ming had laid down a piece of paper, rice paper, and he had what they call the pen, we would just call it a brush, laying there right next to the ink, the black ink, and he showed me how to move my hand so I could make that movement that they make when they do the painting. And therefore, when I did this, when I titled this piece, I felt like it was definitely inspired by him. Yeah, you know, some people think I must be Asian because my work has an Asian feel to it. What was really interesting to me was, these are just my marks, you know, I just call them my marks, and the way they move, the way what I do is just what I do with them. But in this particular one, I was inspired by Zhu Ming, who was Asian, and if you could look really close at this piece, there's a lot of colors. There's some turquoises, I went back in with white and scratched into it. It has just, it has many layers. I think the thing about my artwork is that it's never just a flat surface as far as the painting is concerned. There's always some depth, and part of that is acquired by putting it through the press multiple times, because each time you put a layer over the next, you know, whatever's there already, it changes. It changes into something better, as far as I'm concerned. Once in a while, it changes into something worse. But if it does, then I just put another layer on, and somehow we can save it. Yeah, do you think that it has a feel of a cave painting? I actually think that it's partly because of the black and the amber that it has that feeling for the cave painting. It's really, to me, this whole printmaking process is endless. And I really, I used to paint on fabric, and next Saturday I'm going to be showing my clothing that I used to make, because I still have a lot of it, and it's just fine. And so this particular group of work is a continuation of the kind of movement that I had in the clothing, the brushwork, the kind of lines, quality. This is one of the three tulip pieces. I think it was the last one I did in the series, but I don't remember. I call it emergent tulips because it looks like it's emerging out of something. The background was kept being too dark. This was drawn on the back. It's called trace monotype. So I inked up a piece of plastic that looked like a piece of carbon paper. And then when I drew the tulips on the back, that carbon, the color transferred onto the front of the print. Then I came back in and I painted a lot of the color into this print in order to have it work as a print. Then I got all done. I said, well, these things are floating. I got to do something. So I started going, I just kind of went da 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 da. And when I got all done, I had to laugh at myself because I have seen camel's hump so many times coming around the state that I realized I had made camel's hump over here without doing it on purpose. Which I kind of laughed at myself for that. So this was the Emerging Tulips part of that series.
But it's been very inspirational to me, and I can't thank you so much.
Thank you, James. I really appreciate it.
Well, I appreciate it too. Thank you.